And she will be joining another 10 minutes.
Okay. Welcome everyone to the 10th session of BSPRUD NHSRC series to promote and implement standard treatment guidelines in clinical practice. Today we will be talking about acute stroke management and what are the obstacles or issues that we come across while handling these patients, especially in the remote areas. Today we have a specialist neurologist with us, Dr. Suman Kushwa. She's head of the department, neurology department at Institute of Human Behavior and Allied Sciences. She runs a stroke unit at the hospital. She will be talking about the management of stroke, and I'll be talking about what are the obstacles and how do you come across these. While we are waiting for the others to join, Siddhi has put a pre-test link in the chat box. I'll request you all to fill up, start doing that. It will be a good learning educational exercise for you as well, because these questions have been drawn keeping in mind the various issues that we come across in the management of stroke, or what is the right way of doing it, or in other words, what is the standard of care for management of stroke, and a few things about the awareness about stroke. Because in our experience, we find that the awareness about management of right management of stroke is not good, very good, even in the urban areas and in the higher centers. There are certain myths or there are certain awareness issues that hinder with the management of stroke. So kindly start doing this pre-test. This is just an educational exercise. Don't bother about the scores. But it will take you through the journey of management of stroke. And secondly, this is important to attempt because one of the criteria for issue of certificate of participation is that you attend the entire program and attempt pre and post. We don't look at the scores part, but what is more important is that you attempt doing it. Immediately after submission of the pretest, scores are released, and these scores also give you the explanation about the right answer. So I think you can go through that also. It will help you in improving your knowledge about the management of stroke. So for those of you who have joined just now, we have put the link again here in the chat box. Take your time to do it. Oh, already 60 of you have already submitted. Good, great. Good afternoon, everyone. This is Dr. Sangeeta Sharma. Welcome to the 10th session of NHSRCDSPRUD STG series. Today we will be talking about stroke management. And we have already put the pre-test link in the chat box. I hope you are all attempting it. Many of you have already submitted it. We'll wait for some more time. We have more than 150 people in the room, and about half of you have already submitted it. I hope you have no problem in opening the form here. Siddhi has put the link again in the chat box for those of you who have just joined now. Hello, Deepika.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you?
Okay, I'm good, ma'am. How are you?
Good, good. All good.
Okay. Thanks, ma'am.
Deepika, they are doing the pre-test. Let them finish with that.
So much.
Yeah. Suman, Siddhi Suman has joined. Can you move her to the panelist?
Sure, ma'am.
Yes, doctor, we will be discussing about the management of stroke. Definitely. Today's session is all about this management only. For audio setting, I think you have to look at your own end here. From our side, all settings are good to go. Maybe you try log out and log in again. Okay, yes, Dr. Suman has also joined. Suman, we are about to start. Right now they are doing pre-test.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
I'm there.
Yeah, okay, thank you for joining.
I've already sent you my slides in case it doesn't
work. Yeah, I got it, yeah. Meanwhile, while they are doing it, you can start, you can try screen share.
Yeah, I am.
I think that will save on time.
Question number over.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, but tumhari temporary se hai ye wala hai.
Let me check, no share.
PowerPoint को खोलो।
एक मिनट मैम, I'm just trying. Are you able to see now?
हाँ हाँ, ये ठीक है.
Is it fine? Let me just go through it. Is it moving?
Slide show pe kar lo.
Yeah.
Slide show pe.
I think it's moving.
Yeah. Yeah. It's okay. Okay. Just wait for 2-3 minutes more. About 100 people have already done their pre-test. Just wait for 2 more minutes because some people have joined just now.
Okay.
They'll have some time to do the pre-test.
चलो
ओके थैंक यू बाय
I hope you are doing the pre-test. Start winding it up. We have the expert with us now. I think Deepika, you can start.
Ma'am, thank you, and a very good afternoon and warm welcome on behalf of NHRC. So we welcome you in another lecture series of the standard treatment guideline. And today's session, as Sangeeta ma'am has already mentioned, is on stroke management. And we know that stroke is a life-threatening condition. And it happens when part of brain doesn't have enough blood flow. So this is mostly happened because of the blocked arteries on brain, and it is a life-threatening emergency condition because it's in count. Quicker the treatment, the quicker is the stroke management, and there are more chances of the recovery from the disability. The burden of stroke in India is very high, and it's that. 185,000 strokes takes place in India every year, and further to that, there is one stroke that takes place almost every 4 minutes in India, and it all, of course, death. But apart from that, there is a disability adjusted life years also in involved in the stroke cases. If we talk about management of the stroke, it requires a prompt, rapid transportation, acute diagnosis, and timely intervention to minimize pain, as well as early rehabilitation are essential for the stroke management. So, looking into the seriousness and spirit of this particular disease condition, today's session is decided by Sangeeta and Anderson, and we very welcome. Dr. Suman ma'am. Ma'am is the professor in Department of Neurology. It has Delhi, and a very, very warm welcome. And along with ma'am, Dr. Sangeeta Sharma, well known all of ma'am is also professor in UPS and also the president of the DSPRUD. I'm happy that have many specialists, doctors, CHO, staff nurses, and other professionals joined online, and once again a very warm welcome to everyone, and I hand over, without taking much time, I hand over it to the Sangeeta ma'am to take it further. So
Deepika will start because Suman is here. I don't want to stand in between the expert and the participants who have joined. Siddhi, you can introduce Dr. Suman.
Thank you, Deepika ma'am. Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am. So we have today a very eminent speaker, Dr. Suman Kushwaha. Ma'am is professor and head Department of Neurology and head of Cognitive Neurology Unit at Institute of Human Behavior and Allied Sciences in New Delhi. Ma'am has a core interest in cognitive and behavior neurology and movement disorders. Ma'am has started with the comprehensive stroke unit and IV thrombolysis in 2012. She has also started a group called Samba, which is dedicated to dementia support group. And in 2014, and organized regular sessions for the rehabilitation of patients with permanent disorders. She has been awarded with ISS Stroke Award in 2018 for stroke awareness. She has funded projects as principal investigator with WFN for acute stroke management awareness, saving the brain in East Delhi, ICMR for the drug resistance in TBM, DSG with neuroimaging and physiological correlate of degenerative dementia, mapping of cognitive pathways in the Indian aging population. Ma'am has more than 100 international and national publications. Over to you, ma'am.
Welcome, Suman, for this series. And let me tell you about the audience here. I checked on the Google form that they have filled. We have a pan-India participation from all over India. People are there, more than 200 people are there. Some people sit in groups also in some health facilities. So you can say around 200 people are there. And from all, levels of healthcare. Majority are from the district hospital, but we do have tertiary care people as well as some CHC, PSC people. So you have a range of people. Some are specialists, but most are people working at these hospitals. Some nurses and quality people have also joined the group. And majority of the people are from the government sector. But certainly some corporate hospital people have also joined us. So you have a tough task spanning your presentation right from, primary care level to taking it to the specialized level here.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving me an opportunity on the topic, which is close to my heart. And I think I will be able to justice and I will be able to give some important tips on how to manage the patients of acute stroke. And this, should I start?
Yeah, sure, please. All yours after, finish, then I'll talk about a little bit about the issues and the how do you choose between the thrombolytic agents.
So, as we all know, stroke is an important disorder which is affecting the mankind. And if we see worldwide, there are 20 million people each year who suffer from stroke, and 5 million will not survive. And it is a leading cause of functional and cognitive impairment. 20% of the survivors of the stroke require hospital care after 3 months as well. It means it is very disabling, and around 15 to 30% being permanently disabled. So this is of worldwide, but in India also the prevalence of stroke is around 55.6 per 1 lakh in all ages. And as far as WHO is concerned, in 2005, they have come out with a figure of 0.63 million deaths due to stroke in India. So, we can guess the problem of the stroke.
Suman, we didn't get your slides. I hope, are you talking from slides?
Yeah, I'm talking from slides.
No, but we don't see your slides. You have to share again.
I will. Let me share it again. Is it okay now?
हाँ full slide show पे कर दो बस.
Yeah. Is it okay now? I am audible?
Yes, all good.
Okay. Okay, so we can see the stroke is the second commonest cause of death in India, and about 1,85,000 stroke occurs every year in India, with nearly one stroke every 40 seconds and about one death every 4 minutes. So the problem stroke is humongous, and the responsibility on all the healthcare workers is to tackle this problem at every level wherever they are working, be it a primary care, secondary care or tertiary care. So again, to re-emphasize, this is from the Indian Stroke Association, and according to it, there is 100% increase in the incidence of the stroke because of a lot of factors which we will be discussing. There are a lot of modifiable risk factors which we can control to decrease the incidence of the stroke. And stroke attributes to around 30% of the overall morbidity in India. So the problem is big and it is spread all over India. But there was one report from United States where they have encouragingly shown that overall stroke mortality steadily declined across the world during 20th century. And this means that the decline in the stroke mortality was related to improvement in the emergency services, in the hospital and rehabilitation services. So it is very important to place all these factors, all these components in the healthcare system so that we can decrease the mortality associated with the stroke. We should be having a good emergency services. We should be having the hospitals equipped with treatment of the stroke, and followed that, we should be having a good rehabilitative services. So it basically forms a pathway of the stroke care wherever you are working. So coming to this important diagram, in which as we have a cohort of people who are working in remote areas, in primary care health areas, in district hospitals, and in secondary and tertiary care hospitals. So it is basically the stroke treatment is revolutionized when all these factors in the remote areas have improved, the district hospitals have improved, and the secondary and tertiary care hospitals have strengthened themselves for stroke. So it is basically a responsibility of the whole care system. You should not be waiting for the secondary and tertiary care hospital to refer your patient. So we have to develop the stroke care in the remote hospitals as well as in the primary hospital as well as in the secondary and tertiary hospital. We should basically be having a good stroke care pathway so that we can refer the patient timely to the hospital nearby. So coming again to this important stroke care diagram, in which I am happy that Dr. Sangeeta Madam has taken this effort to train the physicians and the healthcare workers for all the aspects of the medicines. So today we are here at primary care physician level. We are having an educative talk about the stroke so that we can improve upon the whole this gamut of affairs of stroke treatment. So important is primary care physician sensitization about stroke, then professional educational paramedical treatment education also. Then we should be having organized rehabilitation. If we are understanding the stroke as such, then we will be able to understand the role of organized rehabilitation to improve the outcome of the stroke. And the most important thing which I always emphasize is community educations. Unless until we educate the masses, we have to empower the patients to understand the stroke, their symptoms, so that they can reach to the hospital in time and reduce the stroke related with mortality. About suspected acute stroke, emergency services, I will be coming. Now, what happens in stroke? I will try to explain you in the simplest way what is the basic principle which is underlying in acute stroke management. We have to basically target the ischemic penumbra. It is a very simplistic diagram to show the type of strokes we have. Most of the strokes are 85%, which we will be discussing today. and the 10% have intracranial hemorrhage, and subarachnoid hemorrhage constitute around 5% of the patients. So what happens? Most of the cases of acute ischemic stroke is thrombotic, thromboembolic phenomena or thrombotic. So we can easily see that this is an artery, say for example, middle cerebral artery, and a thrombus, which is a bunch of lot of platelets and RBCs, and it has blocked the flow to the other territories. So as a result, what has happened? The infarction. Infarction means the blood supply has suddenly stopped in this area. However, the collateral circulation have started coming up in the picture, but it will take time for the collateral circulations to come into picture. But the important thing which we need to understand, the area which is known as penumbra, it is a viable area which is lying besides the infarcted area. This is a dead area, but we have to save this salvageable area. Therefore, it is always said and emphasized in the treatment of the stroke that the treatment is time dependent. Why I am emphasizing that acute stroke is time dependent? Because in a typical acute stroke, every minute until the reperfusion, that is your treatment, the brain losses around 1.9 million of neuron per minute, 14 million of synapses per minute, and 77.5 miles of myelinated fibers in 1 minute. So every minute counts in strokes. Therefore, the treatment of acute stroke is hyperacute. You have to be hyper whenever you see a patient of stroke to know that every minute which you are losing will be causing the damage of this damage to this extent. And as I will further tell about the acute therapy, that is thrombolysis, and it is also time bound. Now, we can say we will be today talking about only ischemic stroke. If we want to know what are the pathophysiology, so 30% cryptogenic, we don't know the cause of it. Around 25% is small vessel disease, which can be thromboembolic. Others are 5%, cardioembolism is 20%, and atherosclerotic cerebrovascular disease constitute around 20%. So we know the pathophysiology is mainly atherosclerotic and cardioembolic. So the treatment goal is basically restoring the blood supply to ischemic area as quickly as possible. This is the thing which we need to understand. Within 3 to 4.5 hours, we have clot dissolving drugs, Eteplase, for mild to moderate stroke. Obviously, we are not supposed to give this in severe stroke. Within 6 to 24 hours, we have mechanical thrombectomy with stent retrieval for larger arteries. So because of these two therapies which has come up since last two decades, we have a good quality of stroke care in India and a good outcome. Now, before going into the actual treatment, first we should be understanding what are the non-modifiable and modifiable risk factors for stroke so that we can have a preventive management as well. Age we cannot modify, gender we cannot modify, stroke happens more in women. If you have a family history of stroke, then you are at a greater risk of having the stroke, and if you are Asian, African, American, then also you have a great chance of having stroke. So these are the factors which we cannot modify. But coming to the important aspect, that is the modifiable risk factors of the stroke. The physicians, we are responsible for treating the hypertension, diabetes mellitus, hyperlipidemia, atrial fibrillation, and TIAs. So these are the modifiable risk factors which we are responsible for treating the patient. While the patients can modify the other modifiable risk factors, that is smoking. Smoking has direct correlation with stroke. So smoking needs to be controlled. Alcohol, besides it, diet, drug abuse, and physical inactivity. These are the factors. These are basically the modifiable risk factors which we all can play important role in controlling and managing the stroke or preventing the stroke. Now, coming on to the first few hours of the stroke, where we have to save the penumbra, that is the salvageable area around the core, which is the ischemic area. This is dead area, but we can salvage this area around it. And it is important to understand that not only the thrombolytic therapy, but penumbra is also damaged by hypoperfusion, hyperglycemia. If it means if your diabetes is not controlled, you're not going to have a good outcome. Besides, that's fever and seizures. So we have other factors also which are responsible for having the treatment, which are responsible in reducing the penumbra and improving the outcome of the stroke. Again, to re-emphasize, we always have to remember, once we have seen the patient of stroke, we have to rush to the hospital. We have often found that whenever we have a patient of stroke, they usually wait till morning to go to the hospital, to rush to the hospital, because sometimes the patient have stroke while he is in sleep, or there is some small tingling numbness sensation in one part of the body. They will not find it difficult. They will not find it disabling. So they wait for morning, and sometimes they have some headache, which they always have. So they used to take the, they used to pop up the analgesic to take care of that headache, and thought of going to the hospital next day. Another thing is that usually in TIAs, what happens, the patient have multiple short duration neurological deficits. They will be having some weakness in right side of the body, and within 15 to 20 minutes, it will improve. So they will not go to the hospital. They have some slurring of spooies, and then half an hour it improves. They will not go to the hospital. So it is always very important to understand the symptoms, because the symptoms are telling you that you are having stroke and you have to go to the hospital. And hospital, that to be in time hospital. So coming on to what is new, it is actually not new. It is a established treatment of acute stroke. We give intravenous thrombolysis with eltiprase in selected patients with acute ischemic stroke within first 4.5 hours. So it is very important to reach to the hospital within a short window of 4.5 period hours. Aspirin in the patient with cerebral infarction within first 48 hours. There is benefit of reorganized acute stroke unit care, because the dedicated staff is there to take care of the blood pressure and diabetes, which are proportionally related to the improvement in the stroke. There's increasing evidence of benefits of intravenous interventions to correct the disturbed physiology of hypoxia, dehydration, fever, and hyperglycemia in the earlier stage of the stroke. And there's possible extension of thrombolysis time window and a use of neuroprotective agent within 5 hours. And we know thrombolysis since last two decades, since 1999 to till date, has served actually as a catalyst for major changes in the management of stroke. And since 2015, we have interventions which have taken a major role in treating the patients of stroke, which has further improved the outcome of the patient. I will not be talking about intervention today. I will just be talking about the medical acute stroke management. So coming on, I would like you all to emphasize in reducing the stroke risk by controlling the modifiable risk factors, controlling all your physical activities, lifestyle modification, so that you will not be having diabetes, hypertension. You have to manage your weight timely. You have to eat properly, and you have to avoid addiction. You have to avoid alcoholism and smoking. This will, to some extent, will be able to prevent the stroke. Next is to recognize stroke symptoms. This is also very important. And once you recognize the symptoms, then you have to respond at the first sign of the stroke. Now, coming on to how to recognize, what are the stroke symptoms? It is a heterogeneous presentation. You can have anything on the earth when you have stroke. You have a sudden and severe headache. It can have double trouble in seeing from one or both eyes. You can have double vision as well. You can have sudden dizziness or trouble in walking. Or you can have sudden confusion and trouble in speaking. You will not be able to speak. When somebody will ask your name, you will not be able to spell out or speak his or her name. And there is sudden numbness or weakness of face, arm, and leg. So if we see any of these symptoms, see, everything is very heterogeneous in stroke presentation. If you observe any of these symptoms, anything which is of sudden onset, is possibly a stroke symptom unless proved otherwise. And if you see any of these symptoms, then every minute counts. So as a layman, when we talk about the stroke symptoms, we as a physician can understand the stroke symptoms, but we have to teach to the masses, we have to teach to the paramedical staff, we have to teach our nurses, we have to teach almost everybody around about the stroke symptoms. So as it is heterogeneous, we will not be able to understand and remember all the symptoms. There is one acronym which has come, that is FAST. It means F is with face, arms, speech, and time. It was a campaign started in USA, but gradually it has spread all over the world with the name FAST. One or more of the face weakness, arm weakness, or speech is there, then it is that 88% of these patients have stroke. If you have a face deviation, if you have arm weakness, and if you have difficulty in speech. So this FAST is very important to remember. It is very easy. Further, you can see, if you see somebody with facial droop, if he's smiling and his face, the angle of the mouth is deviating to one side, right? Then it is a facial involvement. We call it as face droop. Next, very simple thing which we can say, which you can say to the patient, that just lift up your arm, and if you see one of the arm is lagging behind, that is known as arm drift. You have to hold it for 10 seconds. This is also very important to see whether the patient is having limb weakness or not. Another thing which I've told is speech. You have to just, if the patient is having light slurring of the speech, she is not able to speak clearly, or she is not able to name himself or herself, or she is taking some other, her language is not appropriate, then also there is a speech involvement. When you see a facial droop, a arm drift, and a speech abnormality, then T stands for time, which is very important. You're not supposed to waste a single minute, but to reach to the hospital, nearby hospital, as early as possible. Further, there are two components which have been added in FAST, is BFAST. The B stands for balance. If you see somebody while walking has lost balance and swaying here and there, then you can say that the patient is having a balance problem. And E, if the patient has difficulty in seeing, the blurring vision, then also through balance loss, eye involvement in the form of vision involvement, face, arm, speech, and time makes a simple, very simple acronym called as BFAST for educating the public at large wherever you are. So I would request you guys who are listening today, this BFAST, you have to go to your family members, your neighborhood, your friends, and just make them understand the importance of BFAST so that you can spot a stroke and help them to reach to the hospital in time. So these are the latest guidelines which have been given in 2019. I will not go into the details of these guidelines, but if somebody is interested, this is a good reference to go through all the recommendations which have been there. Now, the important recommendation is to increase both the number of patients who are treated and the quality of care. Educational stroke programs for physicians, hospital personnel, and emergency personnel are recommended. This is what we are doing today. It has got level 1 evidence. So it is class 1 and level B evidence. So this is very important. And this is what we are doing today. And I request you people, whatever you are listening today, you have to go to your hospital, respective hospitals, and talk about the symptoms and whatever you have read today to your juniors and your medical as well as paramedical staff. Now, what happens when we see a patient of a stroke, and when the patient comes to us within a window period of 4.5 hours, all the patients we need, these are all the patients are basically eligible to receive intravenous eltepliase within 1 hour of hospital arrival. So there's one concept of door to needle time. We are talking about a window period of up to 4.5 hours. We suppose that the patient comes to you at one hour only. You are not here to waste your time, because you should not be thinking I can have a window of up to 4.5 hours. As the patient reports to your door means your hospital arrival. So you should be thrombolyzed the patient within 60 minutes of reaching to the hospital, whatever time it would be. So the door to needle time is very important in deciding up the outcome of the patient. The earlier you thrombolyze the patient, the good will be your outcome. So it is very important to understand this door to needle phenomena. The door to door time can be anything. The patient can come in 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, even 4 hours. But your time, when the patient is received by you in your emergency, the thrombolytic treatment should be done within 60 minutes of arrival of the patient. And what is the evidence we have for this? There's a pool data of around 7 randomized placebo controlled trial of IV thrombolysis. And they said the sooner the TPA is given to the stroke patient, the greater the benefit, especially if started within 90 minutes of the symptom onset. So that is what I always teach to my residents and my junior doctors. As the patient comes, we should be actually having a stroke code announced. We have in Delhi, a lot of hospitals have their stroke code, but we have to get activated. The stroke team has to get activated once the stroke code has been announced, so that we can facilitate all these procedure of getting the CT done and making a bed in the ICU and preparing the TPA in the ICU. So there are a lot of evidence. I will not be going to the details of all those evidences, but this ECAS trial basically has increased the window period from 3 to 4.5 hours. So this was an important landmark study which has given us a window period of up to 4.5 hours. Otherwise, it was 3 hours earlier. So the important thing which I want to emphasize here, you have to take the consent of the patient, because this is the treatment in stroke in which the patient will come and ask you what will happen if you are giving me this injection. So there is a possibility, there is a chance of symptomatic ICH in these patients. So the consent has to be written, and the informed consent should be having all the detail about the drug which you are giving and the percentage of the complication of intracranial hemorrhage, so that some patients might say no about listening to the intracranial hemorrhage also. So here the important catch point is that you have to give them statistics that only 6.4% of the patient received TPA will be having the these complications, and these complications at times are manageable. So it is very important to explain the patient the complication versus the improvement in the symptoms of the stroke by giving this treatment. This I will skip. So the onset of the time is very important. The way you ask the patient is important. Like the patient will have a very different way of perceiving the stroke. They will say, ye theek the, ye theek nahi the, ye khana kha ke so hai, ye khana kha ke nahi so hai. The only one question which you have to ask, when was patient normal? Normal means doing activity, talking, walking, doing everything. Because each one of the family member have different story about the stroke. The onset time for us is very important, because from the onset time, we have to calculate the therapeutic window. And once you calculate that time, then you have to, in emergency, you have to calculate this very important score, that is NIHS score. Actually, this will give us the severity of the stroke, because we have to use this scale before we go for thrombolysis. So we give the patient, we have given thrombolysis up to 20 NIHS scale. Beyond 20, you can give, but it is slightly very, the complication may be more if you give in the severe stroke. So it is safe to give up to moderate, around 50 NHS scores. Now, after clinical history, it is very important to diagnose the after clinical diagnosis, you have, when the patient comes to you, the second thing which you have to do is get the CT scan. In the CT scan, CT scan is enough for ruling out the ICH, that is exclusion for thrombolysis, that is absolute contraindication. It can at times give us the early ischemic signs also, but it is normal also. Normal does not mean that stroke has not happened, because in ischemia is usually spotted on the CT after 2 hours, and it is available in almost primary care centers as well, in almost all the hospitals. It is cost effective, and the time is only 5 minutes to get the CT done. And the evidence we have is class 1, and level is 1 also. So this kind of picture you can get in the CT. This is the important aspect score. It basically tells us about the anterior middle cerebral artery involvement. We have divided it into different zones, and the aspect score calculation will also be important in prognostication of the patients. As far as MRI is concerned, if you have MRI, it's good enough, but the CT will also be equally important. The MRI limitations are, it is cost. It takes around minimum 20 minutes to get the FLIR imaging done, and it is not available in most of the places. Yes, sometimes what happens when the patient of stroke comes, there is mimickers of the stroke also. Sometimes the patients are psychogenic. They will be giving the history of hemiplegia, hemiparesis, persistent hemiplegia, hemiparesis. The seizure can also have post-ictal weakness in form of hemiplegia, hemiparesis. Hypoglycemia can also have focal neurological deficit. Migraine sometimes will have neurological deficit. Migraine with aura, in which they can present with hemiplegic migraine. Hypertensive encephalopathy also have sudden neurological deficit, Wernicke's encephalopathy, and all the CNS infections also. So you have, whenever you are making a diagnosis of stroke, just remember these mimics as well, so that you cannot miss these mimics, and unnecessary, we don't want to thrombolize the patient. In 1%, if you have thrombolized any of the mimics also, there's not going to make any difference, right? So don't worry about it, but just be careful about the mimics. The basic investigation which we should be doing before thrombolizing the patient, besides the CT scan, is sugar, obviously, because it has got direct link with the prognosis of the and outcome of the stroke after thrombolysis. Oxygen, electrolytes, complete blood count, markers of cardiac ischemia, yes or no, you can. Prothrombin time usually is not available in emergency, so we don't do it, and ECG we do. The inclusion criteria are simple. Diagnosis of ischemic stroke causing measurable neurological deficit, that is NIHS moderate. Onset of symptom within 3 to 4.5 hours before beginning the treatment, and age more than 18 years. These are relative contraindications. These are no more contraindications, because as we have healthy population nowadays, we are living long because of the medical facilities. So we have patients of stroke over the age of 80 years, and we are thrombolizing them as well. Again, to reemphasize, time is brain. Patient qualified for thrombolysis, in window period 0.9 milligram per kg, maximum 90 milligrams we can give over 60 minutes. 10% of the dose is to be given over 1 minute. An organized protocol is always helpful. A structured protocol is always helpful for your immediate junior doctors and resident doctors and other staff collect the information and to recruit the patients for the acute stroke management. So it's very easy. Once you recognize a patient of stroke, admit that patient in ICU or stroke unit, or even you can do it in emergency as well. infuse 0.9 milligram, maximum 90 milligram over 60 minutes with 10% of the dose given as bolus over 90 minutes. If the patient develops severe headache, it means something wrong has happened, acute hypertension, nausea, vomiting, or worsening of the neurological examination, discontinue the infusion. It is very important to be very vigilant in first 1 hour of the patient, because the patient can develop complication and you even have to discontinue the infusion. Blood pressure management is very important. There is a criteria for doing the blood pressure management. Every 15 minutes initially you have to do, and then every 2 hours, then the up to 2 hours, then every 30 minutes for next 6 hours, and then early for 24 hours after RTPA treatment. So this you can always explain to your ICU nurses, and you can always make a table out of it so that they can take the blood pressure management at this duration. Increase in the frequency of the blood pressure measurement if systolic blood pressure is more than 180 and systolic is more than 105, then you have to give IV levetiracetam to decrease the blood pressure and then only thrombolyze the patient. You are not supposed to do any nasogastric or any invasive procedure while the patient is on IV thrombolysis. And you have to obtain the CT or MRI, preferably CT scan, after 24 hours of IVTPA before starting anticoagulant or antiplatelet. The antiplatelet treatment needs to be started only after 24 hours after the thrombolysis. It's not only about thrombolysis, we need to understand this. You have to do continuous monitoring of heart rate, breathing, and oxygen saturation. Do monitoring of blood pressure, as I've told you, every 15 minutes for 2 hours. Glucose monitoring, you have to do GCS, and after 24 hours, you have to repeat the NIHS scale. If suppose the hemorrhage happen after thrombolysis, then don't worry about it. Sometimes they are self-limiting and they can be self-limiting, or if they are more than 30% of the infarcted area, then they are symptomatic, and then you need to give the fresh frozen plasma to the patient. How you're going to do the management of the blood pressure is very important. As I've told you, levetiracetam 10 to 20 milligrams IV over 1 to 2 minutes. May repeat one time, followed by continuous IV infusion till you get the blood pressure below 185 or 110, then only you are able to administer the TPA in these patients. And after that, maintain the BP below 180 to 105 millimeters of mercury, monitor BP every 15 minutes for 2 hours, and start RTPA therapy every 30 minutes for 6 hours, and then every hour for 16 hours. If you find the patient to be having high blood pressure, if the systolic blood pressure is more than 180 to 230, or diastolic more than 105 to 120 millimeters of mercury, then levetiracetam 10 milligrams IV followed by IV infusion. So blood pressure management at initially is very important. If it is more than 200 millimeters of mercury systolic and 110 millimeters diastolic, then it may be tolerated in acute phase of ischemic stroke without any intervention. But if you are thrombolizing, then you have to reduce this blood pressure. Blood pressure may be lowered if this is required for cardiac conditions also. And upper level of the systolic blood pressure in patients undergoing thrombolytic therapy is 180. So you have to be measuring the blood pressure meticulously in the first hour. Avoid and treat hypotension. Avoid drastic reduction in blood pressure. This is very important. Otherwise, the hyperperfusion will happen. What about diabetes? The high blood glucose level increases the size of infarction. So there are evidences that indicates the persistent in-hospital hyperglycemia during the first 24 hours after stroke is associated with worse outcome than normal glycemia. So it is very important to be vigilant regarding the diabetes status of the patient in acute state. Do treat serum glucose level. It is more than 180 milligrams per deciliter. and achieve a blood glucose level of range of 140 to 180. This is very important, and you have to give that insulin infusion to the patient if you want to achieve this in the acute 1 hour period. Hypoglycemia can mimic acute ischemic infarction. Do treat severe hypoglycemia. This is also very important. So you have to maintain a blood range of around 140 to 180 milliliters milligrams per deciliter. Don't use glucose as maintenance IV therapy. Fluid balance is also another important direct component which will decide upon the prognosis of the stroke. Do regular monitoring of the fluid balance and electrolytic imbalance with severe stroke with swallowing problem, because usually these patients are unable to swallow, and at this time only you have to put in the Ryle's tube so that the proper nutrition and electrolyte balance can be maintained. Do use normal saline for fluid replacement during first 24 hours of the stroke. Don't use dextrose saline, as I've already told you. What happened if the patient has a big stroke, or if the patient has developed complication of hemorrhage? Then the patient is going to have raised ICT, and it is very deteriorating for the patient. So don't use mannitol routinely when consciousness is retained. This is a very common practice among physicians to use mannitol in all the patients of the stroke. So please restrain from using mannitol routinely in the patient of stroke unless the consciousness is retained. For that, for other things which you can do for raised ICP is do head elevation up to 30 degrees, do pain relief and sedation, do use mannitol when there is loss of consciousness, and you can do ventilatory support also, and one can go for decompressive surgery also if there is large supraperitoneal hematoma or hemorrhage. So what does a stroke team consist of? A full-time neurologist, a good neurosurgeon for complication, neuroanesthetist, a radiologist is must. You should be having intensive care unit, but I am not saying that if you are not having ICU, you cannot treat the stroke. You can treat the stroke. Neuroimaging facility, at least CT should be there. Lab surfaces 24 hours for the basic blood sugar and electrolytes. And the important part, because after acute stroke, you will be needing neuro rehabilitation, because that is going to stay with the patient for at least 6 months to improve the deficit which the patient is having. You should be having a good physiotherapy, occupational therapy, and speech therapy. And if the patient is having any cardiac source of cardioembolic stroke, then you should be having a regular cardiac consultation as well. It's all about teamwork. A single person cannot do acute stroke management, because it takes a toll to see the patient in emergency, then shifting the patient to the CT, and then shifting the patient to neurology ICU. And in neurology ICU or in the ward, there is lot of things at that point of time to be done. So your nurses have to be hyperactive in taking the blood sugar, in managing the patient filling up of the TPA, and then monitoring the blood pressure and blood sugar timely, and monitoring the GCS also. So a doctor, a lone person cannot do. You should be having a good team, and you should be educating them timely so that all the protocol at your, wherever you are working, are in place. So it's a teamwork. You built up a team of your people in your hospital, educate them, sit with them, discuss with them, and help the stroke patients. Time is brain, and this is just to show you that till now, in last 10 years, from 2014 to till now, we have almost thrombolized around 450 patients, and our door to needle time was 30 to 90 minutes, which is satisfactory. We have 21 patients who have multi-system complication and who have died, unfortunately. And all the patients are on follow-up with improved NHS. Physiotherapy, the neuro rehabilitation part starts when the patient is in ICU itself. Once the patient, 24 hours, after 24 hours, you can start the patient on physiotherapy, because at that time the patient is receptive, the family members are receptive. And if you start talking about the physiotherapy, the squeeze therapy, and controlling the modifiable risk factors, it will be well taken by the family member and by the patient. So it is an integral part. The physiotherapy, the rehabilitation is an integral part of the management of the acute stroke. And you should always be calling the patient subsequently up to 6 months at least to know that whether the patient is doing the rehabilitation part or not, either or whether the patient are restricted to compliant to their treatment, like for Ecosprin and for antihypertensives and anti-lipid treatment. So it is a good idea to keep these patients on follow-up at least minimal for 6 months and teaching them all the neuro rehabilitation practices. And not to forget about creating the awareness in the community. Wherever you are, you should be having a community besides your hospital, or in the community you are living, you should always be passing up the message of recognizing the acute stroke symptom and reaching to the hospital at time. So community education is also an integral part of holistic stroke management. And Stroke Day is celebrated now. It is all over the world and in India. The World Stroke Day is on 29th October. So it is advisable that the government is doing its bit. They are organizing the different awareness camps. So I request you all to please start organizing, observing these World Stroke Day and any other day, so that we can put the hands together and fight for these diseases. Just to recapitulate, what is important is first face. Ask the patient just to smile. If you can see a weird smile, that the one of the angle is drooping to one side, then the face is involved. Ask the patient to raise the arm, and if one arm is lagging behind, it means there is a weakness in the hand. And ask the patient to speak. If he is not able to speak, anything, or if the speech is slurred, and if he's not able to name the things, then it means the speech is involved. And if these three things are there, then it is an alarming signal for you. Time is very important, and time is money, time is precious. So you have to shift the patient, considering that time is brain, to the nearest facility, whichever is available in the surrounding. And again, to reemphasize, time is brain and we must all act fast. It's our responsibility to take care of all the acute stroke patient, to reduce the burden of the stroke in society. And thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Suman, for giving us the elaborate presentations that can happen, and sharing your experience, what to do, what not to do when you see a stroke patient. Can you stay on? No, I think.
Yeah, I'm staying.
Okay. If you have any questions, you can put it in the chat box. Otherwise, there are a few questions. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. I will be happy to answer.
Yeah. You can write in the chat box. I think your presentation was quite clear. So don't have many questions, but there are certain things. I'm very
happy that you have taken this topic, ma'am, because it is very important to spread the knowledge, and we have to prepare all the medical people for fighting with this stroke problem in India.
You asked one question about awareness of FAST. Around 60% people were aware of this FAST acronym. 40% were not aware from this group. Okay, there is one question about what is if the patient presents after a few days, you know, of having a stroke.
Okay, no worries. If the patient reaches to the hospital few days after the stroke, then we basically look for the etiology of the stroke, for what the patient is having, and for we have to investigate patient to find out the etiology. And if we are able to understand, if we are able to pinpoint the etiology of the patient, then we treat that thing. Say, for example, if the patient is having any cardiac issue, then we have to understand that the patient has to undergo all those cardiac things. One thing which I want to share is here, there is a condition known as patent foramen ovale, which is usually not diagnosed, and the patient have stroke because of the patent foramen ovale. So the detailed cardiac examination, including the dedicated ECG and all the other echocardiography with the bubble echocardiography, is very important to know the type of stroke one is having. So unless until we manage that cardiac issue, the patient is going to have stroke again and again. So we have to extensively say, today I have only spoken about the acute stroke management. Otherwise, if the patient is in the ward, we do all the possible investigation to know the etiology of the stroke. So cardiac is one. Besides that, infection in India is also one of the important causes which is causing the stroke. Besides that, autoimmune disorders. These are also one of the important causes of stroke, right? So there are important etiologies which we need to treat and then prevent the patients for the stroke. Or if the patient is having cardioembolic stroke, then we have to start the double antiplatelet, that is clopidogrel and ecoaspirin, for at least 3 months. 3 to 6 months, and then reduce it to one antiplatelet, that is ecoaspirin, which has to be there for lifelong. And besides this, we have to get the strict control of diabetes, hypertension, and regular checkup for any cardiac ailment in this patient. And if the patient has neurological deficit, we have to subject the patient for extensive neuro rehabilitation, so that, say, what happens when the patient has stroke, there a window period of 6 months in which the maximum recovery occurs through rehabilitation. It's okay when you have lost the window of acute stroke treatment, that doesn't mean at all. If you have come to the hospital within 6 months of the stroke, there is a possibility of improving the disability through neuro rehabilitation and further preventing the stroke, so the other stroke will not happen. Because we have recurrent strokes also, and in recurrent stroke, usually the outcome and the prognosis is very poor.
I think TIA, you know, many a times is ignored, you know, because the symptoms resolve within 30 minutes. Patients remain in doubt whether something happened or not, and especially if the symptoms were not very prominent. These are the patients who are at risk of getting stroke. So do not ignore TIA patients, transient ischemic.
And nowadays, post-COVID, actually, ma'am, this I want to emphasize here. It's a good platform to discuss this, because post-COVID, also because of the lot of hematological imbalance in COVID and post-COVID era, we are now having a lot of young patients with stroke coming in. So if a young patient of any neurological deficit comes to you, you should never be ignoring that patient, because it is a high time. And especially in India, we have a lot of risk factors of hypertension, diabetes in the young individuals. So we have a lot of acute stroke happening in the young patients as well. And another very important etiology is drug addiction, which is rampant in our country. So the patient or the people on drug addiction have a possibility of having stroke. So this is also very important. So these are the risk factors, which are especially the newer risk factors post-COVID.
You know, we had one question also in the pre-test, patients with TIA, you know, sometimes if they have specific problem, vision loss is there. So, you know, many a time, and you had one question, you know, where would you refer the patient? Some of them have responded saying that we will, depends on the symptoms. You know, is it, you know, depending on the symptoms that you will refer to a particular specialist, or, you know, what is the general, you know, guidance, guideline, so that there is no delay in treatment for stroke patients? Because presentation of stroke will vary, you know, people can come up with many different problems.
So usually the stroke related with the eye symptoms, if the patient is having painless vision loss or acute vision loss, then it is a stroke. You have to refer it to either neurologist or a physician. But if the patient is in painful optic nerve involvement, if the patient is having a lot of pain and visual blurring, then she or he has to go to ophthalmologist for diagnosis of optic neuritis. Right.
So painless or painful, this is a distinction.
This is a very important distinction. Yeah.
Distinction. So if it is painless, must think of
sudden. Painless and sudden. And sudden.
Yeah, of course. Sudden, painless, must think of in terms of stroke and refer to a healthcare facility where the patient can be handled. And also, you had one question, ask them one question, whether they would like this stroke patient to be treated by a specialist or a general care physician. Again, around more than 50% said they would like it to be treated with a from a specialist. You know, what is your view? I think you mentioned this in your
This is very important. Just that I have told you that care of stroke, caring a stroke patient is a shared responsibility of each one of us. We don't have a lot of secondary care hospitals. We don't have a lot of tertiary care hospitals. So it is now important to treat the patient at your level only after having a short training of how to take care of the acute stroke patients. Nowadays, we have mobile stroke units as well. The good example is in the Northeast. We have a very good mobile ambulances in which the primary care physician in the remote areas are treating the patients of stroke. So stroke is treatment of stroke is not difficult. It is not complicated. You just have to be confident enough that you have diagnosed the stroke, and giving an RTPA is also a very easy process. We don't need specialists for giving the IV TPA. This we need to understand. The IV treatment, the IV therapy can be given at primary care levels also. And rather, they should be given. The patient should only be referred to the higher centers if they want some intervention needs to be done. Right, if the patient has come late in the window period, and if you want some intervention, some stenting or anything, then only the patient should be referred to the secondary care hospitals. Otherwise, if you have a CT and if you have a good protocol at your place, you can treat the patient of stroke at your own place, wherever you are working.
That answers the question in the chat box. What treatment can be started at the primary care institute? In fact, you can treat this patient at your level. But if you know, someone just in case they feel that they don't have this CT scan facility or RTPA, or they are not confident about it, what first aid should be given to this patient before referring or this patient to higher level?
See, you have to keep in mind that the acute stroke treatment is time dependent, right? If you are near to a facility where thrombolysis is available, so you calculate the time and how much time your patient is going to reach there. If the patient is going to reach there within 4.5 hours, just send the patient to them. If your patient is not going to reach to the higher facilities, then you can give a loading dose of aspirin to the patient at that point of time and then you can refer the patient for further management. Right?
I think, loading dose is 350 milligram, 325 yeah. milligram of yeah. aspirin that should be given to the patient. One thing also be kept in mind when you are referring, you know, how that referral takes place. You know, there are two, three things important here. Immediately EMS, emergency medical services, ambulance should be called. Many a times people think that they can drive down and they can take the patient to the nearest health facility. This is not usually advisable. Ambulance is always preferred over driving on your own, because these EMS people, they have staff with them who can handle any exigencies. They can monitor vitals, they can look at the if there is any deterioration, they can communicate with the hospital, they can prepare them in advance. So pre-hospital notification can be generated by them, and that's also very important. As she's saying, you know, emphasizing time is brain, critical time window. How do you save on this time? This can be saved if you have pre-hospital notification. The hospital where you are sending your patient is ready to receive this patient. Unless otherwise, you know, there will be a lot of wastage. Then this hospital where you are sending your patient should be having some pre-hospital preparation ready to receive this patient, so that again you don't waste time in imaging, you don't waste time in procuring RTPA for this patient. So aspirin, yes, you can give it, but you know, but before you do this, call EMS. You know, I have a friend, he was one of the contributors to our first edition of standard treatment guideline. He himself was a medicine specialist, otherwise very lean, thin, no other problems, but he had a you know, chest pain, sudden chest pain. And I don't know how, and he made the mistake of driving down himself to the health facility. And on his way, he died.
Very soon, ma'am, we are going to have a network of all the hospitals who are providing the primary and the secondary acute stroke management. Very soon, we are going to have a map and tracking of all these. So Government of India is coming up with the all the hospital networking, so that you can have the number of all those hospital which is nearest to you and can reach to that hospital as early as possible.
Yeah, but because many people think that, you know, driving down would be easier or faster.
Actually not.
Let us not think in those terms, you know, because, you know, in hospital, you know, he was such a learned, you know, medicine specialist himself, and he made that mistake, and we lost a very good physician for this. You know, that's one point I wanted to make. There is one question about is MRI useful in stroke patient? I think you answered that, but you can
repeat. Yes, it is very useful, because it is the modality. If it is available, you can get the MRI instead of CT scan. Because MRI is actually able to capture the stroke in few minutes after the onset of the stroke, right? So if you have MRI, you can get the MRI done.
So that means, you know, I was listening to you. You said CT scan takes 5 minutes, and this takes MRI takes 20 minutes.
Yeah.
If the MRI is available, still, then you would go for MRI. But otherwise,
go to MRI, but with special indication and special instruction to the person who is doing MRI to get only the diffusion weighted images done, which is diagnostic for stroke. Only get diffusion images done.
And that will make it faster.
10 minutes. Yeah, that they can and do
that
in 10
will make
minutes.
It faster. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, you can then, do it with MR also.
Okay, then there is a question about the role of tenecteplase instead
of. I've forgotten. I'm sorry, I've forgotten. Tenecteplase is another anti thrombolytic agent which has come up, and it has got equal efficacy with that of the RTPL. So tenecteplase has now taken over. And the important thing is that the giving tenecteplase is very easy. You are not supposed to have any loading dose or anything. You just have to inject the tenecteplase. That's it.
A single IV bolus dose is good enough. But I, you know, okay, you mentioned this, you know, Altiplace is FDA approved for stroke. But
Tenecteplase as well. Tenecteplase as
some
well.
Clinical trials were going on. Yeah. So now it has been approved for the stroke as well. So Tenecteplase giving dose, giving, you know, advantage is there, but it is little costlier than the Altiplase. But then
No. Tenecteplase is easier, cheaper, madam.
Okay. So now it has cost has come down.
Yeah, it is cheaper.
Or it's just the, you know, okay. But side effects are also lesser with Tenecteplase.
The hemorrhage part they say is lesser than that of the Tenecteplase.
Okay.
So we have a safe molecule.
So any of these, whichever is available, can be given. And particularly those who are in remote facility, Tenecteplase giving one single IV bolus is much easier. You know, Altiplase has to be given first as a bolus, then infusion over 1 hour, and then you have to monitor. But the you know, eligibility criteria for, can you just say that again? The eligibility criteria.
It is safe.
But hypertension, what about if the patient is having
hypertension, need to be treated the same as it is in Tenecteplase.
So okay, one more thing, I think she also mentioned about it, blood pressure, you need to control that. This is one of the requirements for thrombolytic therapy. But excessive lowering, you know, over enthusiastic lowering should be avoided. Up to 160/90 mean arterial pressure of under 10 is good enough for thrombolytic therapy. Okay, there is one question about neurogenic. What is that question?
Neuroprotective?
This is neurogenic. Where is it? Neurogenic pulmonary edema in CVA.
Neurogenic pulmonary edema in CVA happens when there is a massive stroke, especially in posterior circulation stroke.
Okay, there is another question about how to manage patient with ischemic CVA of NHIS score of more than 25. How to save these patients?
Okay. Say it is more than 25, it means it is falling into category of severe stroke, right? And there are chances of developing hemorrhage in these patients post thrombolysis. So usually a score of 25 or more, we do not thrombolyze the patient. So you have to do the rest of the treatment, conservative treatment in these. You have to manage the blood pressure, diabetes and everything, and you have to give the patient antiplatelets and then neuro rehabilitation, because subjecting these patients for thrombolysis is a risk for developing complications.
Okay, is CT or MRI valid for delayed presentation?
Yeah, is CT or MRI
valid for delayed presentation? I think they, it means patients presenting after the critical window of 4.5
hours. They are, because CT is not available, the CT centers are full, they don't prioritize the patients of acute stroke, and hence the patient come, many of the patient comes late because they got the CT scan late. So it is always better to have a CT scan of your own in your hospital, so that the patient can be prioritized, that the these patients are of acute stroke, we want to get the CT at the earliest and treat these patients.
There is a question about, in what phase do we give aspirin to the patient? I think that's the first
24 hours after thrombolytic therapy you can start ecoaspirin.
That is preventive therapy.
No. After that, you have to put the patient on antiplatelet.
Okay. There is also one question about this antiplatelet also. Can you elaborate a little on clopidogrel and warfarin drugs in stroke?
See, warfarin needs to be started when you have established that your patient is having atrial fibrillation and your patient is having a clot in the ventricles, in the echocardiography, right? Or sometimes if the clot is not there and the patient has a tendency of going to intermittent atrial fibrillation, then you have to start the anticoagulant at the earliest.
When to take repeat CT brain after initial CT in ischemic stroke? In 24 hours, you said, no?
24 hours after the thrombolytic therapy. Otherwise, if you're not done any thrombolytic therapy, if your patient is fine, don't go and get the CT done. It's only when your patient deteriorate, whether you have given thrombolysis to the patient or not, you have to repeat the CT. Because in posterior circulation, the patients usually deteriorate after 72 hours. So you have to see the increase in the volume of the stroke, and then because it is very important that the patient needs neurosurgery of decompression for decompression if there is increase in the size of the stroke in posterior circulation.
What is the danger sign that we look for in repeat CT brain?
The ischemia, the ischemic infarct which you had seen earlier, or whether you have not seen it earlier, if there is hemorrhagic transformation in the infarct, then it is one of the dangerous signs. And if there are any signs of raised ICT, like there is tenatorial herniation, then they are the signs in which the neurosurgery inputs are important, and decreasing the raised ICT is important.
What is the association of stroke and COVID vaccine?
Oh, this is a million-dollar question, actually. I would not be able to actually give you the evidence-based thing on these points, but yes, because of the COVID vaccine or because of the COVID per se, not only vaccine, COVID per se, there is a lot of alteration in the coagulation profile of the patients, right? So if anything happens to your coagulative system, coagulative profile, the hematological profile, there is a tendency of thromboembolism. So there are some reports of increase in the stroke incidences after COVID, but I would not say after COVID vaccination, but yes, you can have because of the change in the the coagulative profile of the patients. It does happen.
Vaccine, anything, actually, we don't know, as you said, you know, it could be because of the COVID itself or the vaccine. You know, a lot of controversy that rose recently in media, for any vaccine to come to market, it takes a lot of time, 10, 15 years, it is tried in thousands of patients. But here, because of the emergency that we had, because of the pandemic, a lot of it was expedited. So some of the rare side effects would not have been visible during the clinical setting, you know, the trial setting here. So anyway, this is true about any drug. If the side effect is rare, 1 in 10,000 patients or 1 in 1 lakh patients, if that is the incidence of a side effect, it won't be revealed during the clinical trial. So, you know, I think this was quite overhyped that this vaccine had it, and why didn't we know about this? Some of these rare ones will be visible only when that particular 5 times the number of that patient, you know, if it is 1 in 1 lakh, at least 3 times, 3 lakh patients or 5 lakh patients are exposed to it, then only that adverse effect will be revealed.
And we have to see the brighter part of it, that it has saved so many people.
Yeah.
Vaccination actually helpful in controlling the epidemic.
Yeah, and it gave us time to prepare for management of the, otherwise we would have been so overloaded with the you know, patient load, and we would have lost many more patients. I think this is not a question, but it, somebody is trying to reaffirm that all stroke patients for secondary prevention, aspirin should be continued for lifelong.
Yes.
One more thing I would like to say, you know, many of these patients, stroke patients, they present for the first time with hypertension. You know, what is your experience? And, you know, they were never, either they never tested for it before, or they were not hypertensive earlier. Maybe the hypertension was silent earlier, and they think that this is for the first time that they had this hypertension, and there is no need to take antihypertensive therapy after, you know, the stroke, acute stroke is over. What is your experience about this? I think, did I make my question clear?
Yeah. Because the patients actually have actually not got their blood pressure checked in the past. So they are not knowing what is the status of the blood pressure. So whenever you ask them, are you hypertensive? They will always say no. And on asking again and again, then they will come up, yes, ek bar hamara blood pressure zyada aaya tha, humne dawaiyan li thi and it has gone, so that we are not on any treatment. So hypertension is one of those factors or one of those components which, if controlled well in time, will save lot of strokes. So it is to emphasize to the patient, it is our duty to empower and educate our patients to be vigilant about their blood pressure, because as such, when you cross 50 or 60 year old, your arteries become hard and the resistance become less. So you tend to, this all tend to increase your blood pressure. And once you are hypertensive, you need to take the antihypertensives also lifelong. You can reduce the dose, but you just cannot stop these. And sometimes if the blood pressure is not controlled, then the patient will come to the emergency in unconscious state with large hematoma. And then you have no choice and nothing to do for that patient. So it is always important to control your modifiable risk factors as much as you can.
So public education is very important. Hypertensive patients, so make them clear that you know, they would need antihypertensive therapy continuously. You know, day before yesterday, some of my friends, person came, he had slurring of speech, had a you know, stroke, and he was hypertensive at that time, and within 5 days they were restless ki hamara speech theek nahi hua hai. And they were least bothered about their hypertension part.
Hypertension, yeah.
You know, so prepare your patients that this hypertension, it is very important to control hypertension, and they would need longer treatment or lifelong treatment. Maybe dose can be, number of drugs can be reduced, but they would certainly need. And as Dr. Suman was saying, these symptoms, paralysis or speech, you know, it would take some time to go. Many a times they expect, you know, immediately theek ho jayega, speech mera ekdam theek hona chahiye. You know, reasonable, you know, these recovery takes some time. So a lot of restlessness, anxiety or doctor shopping happens because of these, because they have not been prepared. They have not been prepared, you know, how, what would be the course now onwards, you know. That's one thing. Then, okay, there is any list of tests which can be recommended in the community and who have never been to hospital?
Blood sugar, kidney function, and ECG.
These, I think, one, opportunistic screening is one option here. Opportunistic screening is any patient who comes to your health facility after the age of 14, and now it is 18 years, after, you know, any patient who comes to hospital, at least measure BP and sugar. BP is definitely sugar, depending on, you know, if you think it's a high risk patient, should be. So instead of waiting for the patient to come up with symptoms or with, you know, things like MI or stroke, it is important that we recognize these symptoms much in beforehand. There is question about for COVID patient, can we give prophylactic thrombolysis therapy?
No.
How long does this risk of thromboembolism last after COVID or COVID vaccination?
This is in vain because we have now a cases of long COVID and the changes of COVID infections still going on in our bodies. We don't know what is new there for us in future to look upon. So we have to keep our fingers in the latest research going on long COVID and the changes of the COVID on our bodies. So it is in years to come, we will be able to know about all these changes.
Then I think this was answered. When to start Ecosprin in community dwelling stroke patients where imaging is not available? I think the question is not very clear.
If you have diagnosed stroke, what kind of stroke, it is important, because in ischemic stroke, you have to start on the same day. For hemorrhagic stroke, you have to wait for 3 months and then you have to start Ecosprin. You have to wait for 3 months if a patient is having hemorrhagic stroke.
Even when patient is not thrombolized, is there any need for repeat CT brain in ischemic stroke?
No. If the patient is not deteriorating, there is no use of getting it done.
So clinical deterioration is the...
Yeah, is must.
Okay. Any app to calculate NIHSS score, any dose of TNK in stroke?
Yeah, they are available online. We have a NIHSS ka, training session also. You can get yourself trained and get certified and can do it.
If there is any link, you can post here in the chat box.
I don't know. I am not having it, but I will give it to you so that you can get yourself NIHSS certified.
Okay. So this is online?
Online. It is online.
Okay. So they can access this. Yeah. Okay, those who are interested.
Yeah.
Okay. When to give aspirin, clopidogrel and low molecular weight heparin if patient is unfit for mechanical thrombectomy and IV thrombolysis beyond 4.5 hours?
So there's no use of giving low molecular weight heparin plus aspirin plus clopidogrel. If your patient is having some thromboembolic phenomena, your patient is having atrial fibrillation, then there is a role of oral anticoagulants, right? But in ischemic stroke, for 3 months, you have to give dual platelets and then reduce it to one platelet. But if the etiology and the cause is atrial fibrillation and the heart is the issue, then you have to give the anticoagulants lifelong. As far as heparin is concerned, the indication of heparin is only in cortical venous thrombosis, that is venous stroke.
Dr. Sanjeev Puri is asking, they have a 10-80 place for MI patients in their hospital, but there is no CT scan. What would we advise the patient? Without CT scan, can they?
You cannot do.
You have to get diagnose this, you know, whether it is ischemic or hemorrhagic, rule out hemorrhagic, and then only give the thrombolytic agent. How to know whether the patient resistant to aspirin when he presented as recurrent stroke, even patient already on aspirin?
There's a test available with Lal pathology, aspirin antibodies.
But how common is that?
It is not very common.
So should we be bothered about it?
No, we should not be.
Okay, is it for the academic?
It is not of use. We have tried in 2-3 patients, but it's not of use.
So it is just a academic interest for those in teaching.
In clinical practice, research. It has not been done.
So no relevance in clinical practice. Okay. Role of neuroprotective agents like citicoline, piracetam, edaviran, are they useful in present day?
There are no evidence-based studies for these agents. So please don't increase the budget of the patient by prescribing all these drugs at all. Please, because patient should be having money for lifelong ecosprin, atorvastatin, clopidogrel possibly, antihypertensives. We don't want to give all these medications ever.
Role of intra-arterial thrombolysis stenting.
It is a mode of treatment if your patient is in window period from 6 to 12 hours. Then you can subject your patient for intra-arterial all the interventions available.
How to proceed in case of malignant MCA infarct?
You have to give decompressive therapy. Medical decompression means you have to give the patient mannitol 8 early for 24 hours to 48 hours and then stop it. And the only thing which is effective for malignant MCA infarct is decompressive surgery, which can save the patient.
There is a question about preventive measures for stroke apart from modifiable risk factors.
Maintain your weight, eat good food, have mindfulness so that your stress is decreased, and control your factors if you have. These are the factors. Do regular physical activity.
Citicoline to answer kar diya, Dr. Saab. No role. Piracetam injection, citicoline. There is no role of these. I think we had a marathon session of question answer today, and you were you have answered all those wide variety of questions. I will just quickly, summarize these, and some are one or two issues, just to re-emphasize. I think she has already covered the length and breadth of the stroke management, but let's see, quickly go through this, how do you common issues are delayed medical attention. Many times patients themselves keep dilly-dallying. They are not sure of, what these symptoms are and whether they should be approaching the health facility. And of course, access to specialized care, inconsistent use of protocols is another issue. Managing comorbidities along with the management of stroke is very important. Rehabilitation and follow-up doesn't happen many a times. Medication adherence is poor because these treatment needs to be taken for lifetime for with antihypertensives, with this preventive therapy, lipid lowering therapy. So, and they also need psychological support, education, coordination of care, and financial barriers are the major issues with the management of stroke. And as I said, lack of coordination between the primary care providers, EMS, and the specialist also adds to the delays in getting attention. And as I mentioned earlier, EMS, if you have to opt between various sources of transport, opt for EMS, because this will help in reducing the response time, and the quality of EMS is also in fact important. Comorbid conditions need to be managed. Hypertension, diabetes, atrial fibrillation, kidney disease, these also can influence the outcome of stroke as well as the medication choices. And poor or no education about self-care can lead to readmissions and complications. So if they are not mentally prepared for control of antihypertensive, even when I have seen many patients saying, abhi to mera blood pressure controlled hai, so why should I take these medicines? They fail to recognize that their BP or diabetes is controlled because of these medications. So we need to keep re-emphasizing these issues to these patients. And then failure to address emotional and psychological needs, which can hinder recovery of these patients. There are many myths about stroke management. Many people think they are not preventable. When it has to happen, it will happen. It affects elderly only, and its symptoms are always severe or easily recognizable, which may not be true. You know, patient may not be able to clearly articulate, you know, what is happening, you know, to them, particularly when there are certain, you know, subtle vision changes or some problem. When they are drastic, no, people don't miss it, but problem comes when these early or mild symptoms are there. And once the symptoms subside, danger is over. There is a danger of getting recurrence of TIA. So these are the patients that who are at risk of getting full blown stroke. So do not ignore these patients. And stroke recovery, many people think that after few months it doesn't happen. Best period is 6 months, but I think up to 1 year, some
up to 1 year.
Up to 1 year, some improvement can happen, and rehabilitation, many people think, is only for regaining physical abilities, but there are occupational, you know, there are other dimensions to rehabilitation. The speech therapy, you know, is also important. Then people have to go back to their work, so you need to prepare them, and they can live normal lives, and strokes are always painless. What do you say about this, Suman?
Are usually painless, but once the recovery starts and once you don't do the physiotherapy, then the pain start because of not using that particular limb, and that pain is basically chronic regional pain syndrome. If you don't use that limb for so many hours, for so many weeks, so months, so it has become painful after the stroke has happened because of the disuse. It has acquired a same position, it has become dystonic and very painful. But yes, in posterior circulation stroke, in midbrain stroke, we do have some abnormal phenomena, pain-like sensation in the limb. That is very disgusting, that pain. That is because of the thalamus and thalamic fibers. So that is.
So we mentioned about patient education, awareness, misinformation. So I think today a lot of our misinformation point has been taken care. I need not, golden hour, I think, is the one take home message. It is a critical, there is a critical time window. This is a time sensitive issue where you need to act fast and within as early as possible. Thrombolytic therapy, if can be given, will improve the outcomes here. So critical, you know, there are timelines for each of them. So, and there are advantages. I think I've already said about this. Early recognition and response, emergency response is very important. Hospital pre-notification and rapid imaging. If you are able to do this within 1 hour and the patient can be put on this thrombolytic therapy, we can save a lot of damage happening to this. The standard of care remains the reperfusion therapy with the intravenous thrombolytic. Alteplase has been used, is approved for stroke. Tenecteplase, we discussed about this, that tenecteplase can be used as an alternative wherever the patient is in remote area. But do remember about the contraindications, because patients who are at risk of bleeding, or you know, who had recent surgery, some INR is raised, or very high BP, sometimes allergic reactions may happen. So, and incomplete clot dissolution also may happen. Can you, Suman, can you put a, you know, elaborate on, suppose you gave one injection and there was incomplete clot dissolution. So what do you do? How do you go about this?
So, it is basically the reperfusion studies, which we do after thrombolyzing the patient. Okay, so there are criteria on imaging in MRI, whether what thrombolysis therapy you have given, whether it has reperfused the whole area or not. There's a scoring system. So in the good comprehensive center where the intervention is available, after IV thrombolysis, the patient is subjected for this reperfusion measures. And if one finds that there is a partial recanalization or no recanalization at all, then further the digital subsection angiography is performed on that patient. And further, within 12 hours of the stroke onset, you can have a window of getting the intervention done in intracerebral vessels for the perfusion.
What about reocclusion?
Reocclusion can happen any time if the stroke, if the risk factors are not controlled, and if any other pathophysiology causing the ischemia occurs, then you can have a recurrent stroke.
So then you have to repeat the thrombolytic injection.
You can repeat the thrombolysis after 6 months of again you can give the thrombolysis after 6 months.
So, and the major problem with this hemorrhagic transformation in stroke patient, it can happen. So you have to be careful about this. Then intracranial hemorrhage can lead to severe neurological deficits. So you need to monitor these patients very carefully, especially during the first hour. And then expenses, of course, we need to keep in mind. While choosing, I think one has to keep in mind the value for money. If this is in terms of efficacy, safety, suitability, and the cost. But we may not have much choices available here. As someone was saying, now cost of tenecteplase has gone down. So it may not be very difficult to choose. But when these drugs were introduced, the cost was enormous. So then at that time, you had to make a choice between whether you will go for which one of the thrombolytic agents. But remember this. So Altiplase or tenecteplase, whichever you can use this. Following a standard treatment guideline is very, very important here. I think I first is that prioritization of treatment, early recognition, EMS activation, initial assessment, imaging, fibrinolysis. These are the prioritized ways of managing stroke. And then immediately after stroke, what all should be done? Managing airway, breathing, circulation, nil orally. Swallowing assessment should be done. IV fluids, to be given to patients with altered sensorium only, neurosurgical. So all these immediately following acute stroke, how do you manage fever? Some patients may have some raised body temperature. How important is it to control fever, Suman? Can you just...
Fever control is very important because increase in temperature is directly proportional to the damage of the neurons. So you even have to keep the patients in cold environment and control the infection so the temperature will not be there, and try to make all the arrangements to keep the patient to the lower temperatures.
Lower
will be in hypothermia always helps in improving the ischemia.
So besides this, early supportive care general is an important position. Mobilize patients as early as possible to avoid bed sores, contractures. You can allow sitting, standing, walking with caution as early as possible, preferably within 24 hours. Delayed will hamper recovery. Early mobilization, full range of motion exercises, oral care, swallowing,
swallowing one thing I would like to emphasize here, swallowing is very important, and it is our duty to teach the staff of our ICU and in the ward. There's a very simple swallow test which they can do. It's given on internet how to do a swallow test. You have to just give the simple water with the help of the spoon to the patient, because if without any problem the patient is able to deglutate that, that's okay. If there is a slightest of coughing coming out, then you are not supposed to give any oral feeds to the patient, because most of our patients' relatives are worried about that the patient is not has his feed. They try to feed the patient orally, and then the patient finally ends into having lot of congestion in the lung because of aspiration and further deterioration in the recovery of the patient. So that simple swallow test, very beautiful videos are available on internet for the swallow test. So it is a high time that if each one of us, we should be doing swallow test in all the patients who are in altered sensorium, especially in the stroke, to improve the stroke outcome finally. The swallow test is very important.
Then nutrition, management of seizures, you know, many patients, you know, you mentioned about mimics of stroke, and sometimes they may present with stroke. You know,
stroke, usually the stroke which are present with seizures are etiologically cardioembolic, right? So in these patients, the patient will be having a treatment of seizures as it is done as a protocol of the seizure management. If the patient is having multiple seizures, then you have to dilantinize or giving the valproate. But if the patient is having single seizure, then you can just start the anti-epileptic drug as it is in the normal dosages and treat the stroke.
But there is no role of prophylactic anti-seizure medication.
No, not at all. Not at all. If the patient is not thrown seizure, then you are not supposed to give any anti-epileptic treatment.
Bladder care, you know. Avoid any indwelling catheters as far as possible. If used, assess daily and remove as soon as possible. They are source,
infection.
Source of infections, and if required, intermittent catheterization can be used for urinary retention or incontinence. Bowel care is equally important. Impacted feces with spurious diarrhea. So reviewed, I think one important thing here is many times constipation develops, and we put on these laxatives, and these patients remain on these laxatives. So one has to also review, are there any drugs that we are giving that cause constipation? So removal of that drug or change to another drug which does not have this particular adverse effect would be more useful rather than adding another. This is called cascade prescribing, that to treat one side effect of one drug, we add another drug, yet, there would be another adverse effect and we add another drug. So that's how, polypharmacy happens. So bowel care must review the medications being taken by the patient. Avoid infections, DVT, UTI, pneumonia. But prophylactic antibiotics are not needed. Aspiration can happen, but once you have to assess that, and then if required, give antibiotics, but no routine prophylactic antibiotics for this. And prophylactic venous therapy should be given, especially you can avoid, have early mobilization, optimal hydration. If you are able to maintain this will help in avoiding DVT, but if it required, then heparin low molecular can be given. So standard of care for stroke, post-stroke, secondary prevention, long-term management, and rehabilitation has to be individualized for this reason. All these things have been enumerated in our very recent 7th edition of standard treatment guideline. All these steps immediately, what do you do, supportive, thrombolytic, TIA, long-term management, And I forgot to introduce, Suman was one of the lead contributors for this chapter on central nervous system. And stroke has been dealt very elaborately in this book. If you want, you can refer to these guidelines for that. This is the general format of the book, and I think if we follow the standard treatment guidelines, we can close these gaps, we can reduce practice variation, have patient safety, improve patient outcomes, quality improvement is there, and knowledge transmission translation is there, and this can happen only with the use of these standard treatment guidelines. With this, I think we stop here. And next session is on polycystic ovarian syndrome. This will be on 20th of July. I think that is another very important topic, a rising problem. Many of the young people are being diagnosed with PCOD. So I think post-test link is already there in the chat box. You can start attempting doing it. A reminder to you all, attempting post-test is very important. Unless you do both pre and post certificate, you will not be eligible for the certificate. One more question, quick question. Role of 3% sodium normal saline in stroke?
I have no idea.
I don't think this. So it is used.
Yeah.
I don't think so. Yeah. Caesar, I think that question I have already you answered. When patient presented as Caesar in ischemic stroke, treated with phenytoin, shall we need to give it even after discharge?
No.
3 months, is it?
If the patient is presented with Caesar, yeah. You have to continue it because it is symptomatic Caesar, and you have to continue it for 1 year. 1 year.
Thank you. Is there a protocol for those in AAM, Ayurveda, your meaning, to follow in the sub-health set? I think the principles remain the same, whether you are seeing patient at a primary healthcare center or wellness center. Recognition is clinical, that you recognize. If you have facility, you have to hear healthcare wellness centers, they have to speedily transfer these patients to a healthcare facility for the needful, and all those precautions should be followed for that. I think we have done all with all that. Please, can we do thrombolysis in brainstem or cerebellar infarct?
Yes. Of course, we can do. It is equally effective in posterior circulation as well.
I think with this, I will thank Suman so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Because I always like to interact in these public forum because it is important to empower everyone. If we really want to improve the stroke and the other important disorders.
You wanted that a questionnaire, Thanaka, dementia wala. Would you like to put it here?
Next time.
I mean, if it is ready with you, you can post it here. Because people are still doing the post-test.
We want to have one for dementia as well, sometime, anytime when you like it.
Okay. Next series, you know, okay, one more thing. We are, planning for the next series. You can suggest topics of your interest, coming from directly from the end user would be helpful because these, topics are decided, we have 2-3 criteria for that. One is that what you see at the health facility, or where there is a lot of clinical variation, or where there are a lot of problems with the management. So you can suggest some topics here. Some of the topics have already been covered in these last 2 years, and YouTube links are available. Those you can access those sessions on the YouTube channel of NHSRC. So I don't think so we need to repeat those sessions, but if there are any additional topics that you would like us to address, you can post it here.
I have posted that questionnaire.
Okay, just tell them what it is about.
Dear doctors, we know that our population is aging and we have a lot of people. Our parents, if you see, are more than 70 years old, and our population is aging. It's a universal phenomena. And with aging, there are a lot of degenerative disorders which comes. Especially the very important one is memory impairment. मुझे कुछ याद नहीं हो रहा, मुझे नाम याद नहीं रहते हैं. So this is not normal actually. When you get old, forgetfulness is not normal. So this is another very important neurodegenerative disorders which we want to help you guys in understanding the problem of dementia, especially Alzheimer's disease. So here we just want to know ki what all you know about these dementing disorders, how you assess the dementia or the memory impairment or other cognitive deficits if someone comes to you, and what are the new treatment options which are available, and how can we help these patients. So if you spare just 10 minutes, we will be able to know the feedback, and we will be able to design a good talk with the help of Dr. Sangeeta here, so that the dementia, which is known as a new pandemic impending in India because of lot of aging population, we will be able to do the justice in helping them out to have a good quality of life. So I just request you to just fill up that performer, that questionnaire. It's a very simple questionnaire, nothing great about it. We just want to know how can we help you in understanding the neurodegenerative disorder and what are the new things which are available. So
there is a link in the chat box with the dementia questionnaire. You can open this and do this after finishing the post test, because I think post test is important because they will not get certificate without that. But you can open this link and do it later. Meanwhile, Siddhi has already put the post test link in the chat box. Please open that and start doing that. I think some of you have already started submitting it also.
And if you are not able to follow anything in today's lectures, please let Dr. Sangeeta know so that we can help you out. And
Suman, yeah, there was one somebody asked about that education material leaflets that you showed.
Yeah, we will be able to provide it to you. Just give us 1 or 2 weeks and we will be able to. We have some, but some we are in preparation. We will be able to provide you that.
Thank you, ma'am. It was very informative session. I have posted a post-test link, feedback link, and the YouTube channel link. Please, please, please give your valuable feedback so that we can improve, and also suggest topics for the upcoming SPG sessions. So whatever you feel like is practically you need at the field level, you can suggest the topics related to the treatments, more from the primary healthcare point of view. And we will try to incorporate all those suggestions in our next lecture series. Thank you, Suman ma'am. Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Suman. Thank you.
Can I leave now?
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
We'll finish this post test. You can leave. I you know, she was out of station, and but she took
yes,
time
ma'am. To work.
You can add Siddhi dementia in the list of topics.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I'll add that.
And that's very important. I hope you have all opened the post test link and the feedback form. posting the dementia questionnaire link again in case you have missed it.
I'm adding that to the current link only so that they can access it.
Okay.
And can we end?
Yeah, it just let me see the hostess form. Hostess has only been done by around 80 people.
Okay.
Whereas pretest was 137. Maybe they are in the process.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope you all have opened the link. Can we finish, end the session, or should we keep it open for some time? Anesthesia topic. What exactly in anesthesia do you want us? Syndromic children. Can you elaborate? I am not able to follow. ENT topics, okay. Okay, syndromes, okay. Okay, I follow this. I think Siddhi, you can end the session. People can keep doing.
Okay, ma'am.
Pediatric neonatal care, dementia. Okay.
And I have noted the all the topics suggested by the participants.
Okay.
We can have a discussion and then we can finalize the topics.
Okay. In the question, they are saying the state choice, Delhi NIA. Delhi bol gaya hai, Delhi hai. It is there. Acha, feedback form mein nahi hai. Okay. Let me see. Thank you for pointing out.
Thank you, ma'am.
We've got only 5, not many responses. People are not giving feedback.
Okay.
Adult vaccination is another, yes.
Yes, ma'am. I have noted it. And also, we can include a session on HPV vaccines.
That will include adult immunization. Maybe we can have 2 parts, pediatric and adult.
Yes, ma'am. Then we can have like 2 sessions.
Within one session, we can divide it into 2.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Because some of the things will be common, so there is no need to repeat.
Also, I'll check with ma'am HWC's checklist, like whatever, like applicable topics.
Yeah.
We can add that also.
I'm leaving Siddhi.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.